Well, quarantine life continues across the nation and around the globe, and that means we're doing something a little different here at MMA Junkie. We can't really go cover any live events. We can't bring any coverage like we like to do from big fight cards. So instead, we're just going to get together and talk a little bit of mixed martial arts. So my name is John Morgan. Of course, I'm in Las Vegas, Nevada, a shut down Las Vegas, Nevada. It's Friday night. I'm not even technically working today, and there's absolutely nowhere to go because every hotel is closed down, and we're all hanging out doing our social distancing. Meanwhile, Mike Bohn is with me from up in Toronto, Canada, where I'm sure it's much the same there. What's the scene like in Toronto, Mike?
Yeah, it's much the same. There's not really too much else to do. I mean, I'm pretty close to day 14 of, you know, the social distancing, isolation, whatever you want to call it. And even if you go outside, though, there's nothing to do. There's no gyms open. There's no grocery stores open. There's no restaurants, bars, clubs, anything like that. So even if you are technically through your isolation quarantine period, it's not like there's anywhere to go anyways.
Yeah. Well, hopefully soon enough, we'll get through this period. I know it's kind of an uncertain time for us all, but hopefully we'll get through it. We'll have some actual fights to talk about. In the meantime, right now, clearly not what we probably wanted to talk about when we started scheduling this, but something that we have to address, of course. John Jones, clearly the biggest topic in the sport right now, arrested again, allegedly drunk driving, basically, is the charge, aggravated DUI. A firearm was found in the vehicle as well. And of course, it was a gunshot that initially caught the officer's attention to initiate the investigation. We haven't seen any charges as far as the weapon being fired. John said he didn't know anything about it, but overall, just some clearly disturbing scenes, to say the least. We got to see the body cam footage as well. Of course, that's public record as well, and the police made that available. Mike, just give me your initial thoughts on this, because of course, man, we're used to seeing, unfortunately, John Jones in trouble, man. This is not the first incident that he's had, but I don't know. This one strikes me a little different, and I'm not sure exactly why. Talk to me about the way you're taking this initially.
Yeah, well, I think probably the reason it strikes different is the involvement of the weapon, the whole aspect of him having a gun in his possession, you know, allegedly fired it off and everything. That kind of adds a layer of concern, because it's like, oh, this was a person that was seemingly driving around a car, in a car with alcohol in their system, with a weapon. Like, that's just a very concerning combination of details that, you know, allegedly happened. That kind of is probably why it strikes you a little different, of being like, okay, well, it seems like this isn't just like the same old something that we've dealt with him before. There's a new layer of something that's like, you know, a worsening element to it. So I really don't like that aspect to it. And I think that's what's ringing the most alarms to this whole thing. And of course, it's just a repeat line, you know, pattern of behavior that we've seen with John Jones over the past 8 years or so. And it's just, it's worrisome. And you kind of wonder exactly what is going through his mind. We saw that body cam footage that we can get into a little bit later here, that was concerning as well. And you just wonder, you know, everything was seemingly going so good for him. What happened that really triggered this?
Yeah, you know, that's the thing, I guess. You know, first of all, let's just say, unfortunate timing for John Jones, number one, because there is no other news to talk about. Yeah. So this thing is going to live in the spotlight for quite some time. We're going to have to, every aspect of this, I think, is going to be kind of, you know, focused on over and over as we go along. So that's rough. That said, you know, look, getting intoxicated, I got no problem with that, man. You know, no issue whatsoever. You know, everybody's got to handle that on their own as far as they deal with alcohol. But that's his decision. The drunk driving, scary. Now, of course, he wasn't actually operating the motor vehicle at the time that the police stepped in, but he did admit to operating it early in the night and said that he was going to operate it again. So I think there was the intention of going and carrying on, you know, in an impaired state. He did, of course, test on the breathalyzer, so it wasn't just the field sobriety test. That's a problem. Drunk driving is definitely a problem. It's not good. But yeah, the firearm, man, that is the real problem that I have here, that's a little bit scary. Now, we don't know if he fired that gun yet. I'm sure that we'll find that out through the investigation. There was a spent shell casing, it sounds like, from what they found there. So it certainly seems at first glance that that's maybe what happened. But again, that's all alleged. We'll find that out through the investigation. But that is very, very scary. But I think, you know, the body cam footage, and you touched on it there, and maybe you could talk about how you feel as well. But, you know, watching that, I think the thing of seeing that is I'm worried about John Jones as a person, man. I think when we initially thought about this, it's, oh, there's John Jones going and partying again. And that's kind of what everybody said. But, man, to me, there's more to it. I mean, the guy, the, you know, the thing is always said, well, why not have a driver? The guy has a driver. He has a vehicle and a driver available to him that could be used. He chose not to use them. You know, and as you said, out on the streets, you know, there's quarantine right now. There's nothing going on. There's not people out that you can go hang out with. So if he wanted to get, you know, intoxicated, blackout drunk, he could have done it at home. No problem whatsoever, and been a lot safer. To me, there's something else going on that John feels the need to go out and get into society and be out there and you know, again, talking to these homeless people, apparently. I mean, good for him. If he said, you know, I just wanted to talk to these people and treat them like humans. Hey, man, that's great. But not at 1 o'clock in the morning, not during a quarantine, not when there's no, it's not good, you know, and that overall, watching that body cam footage, I mean, that was not the body language and attitude of a guy that's out there partying and stuff. I mean, I don't know. I'm the farthest thing from a psychologist or any type of, you know, counselor or anything like that. But to me, I don't think we're necessarily just talking about a guy with addiction. You know, when people say, I hope John Jones gets the help that he needs. You know, it's not what kind of help. I don't think it's, you know, I don't think it's that he needs to have addiction help. I think there's some kind of underlying, I don't know if it's depression or some type of emotional issues that he needs some assistance with as well. And I hope that's the help that he gets, because this is just some odd behavior.
Yeah, I think you got it pretty, you know, nailed it pretty good. There's definitely just a pattern of really, really poor decision making. And that's, you know, what triggers him to make those poor decisions. Again, we're not psychologists. We don't really know exactly what could all characterize him to going that. You know, some people call him a sociopath, whatever the case may be, whatever labels you may want to put on him. But it does seem like, you know, he gets to these points, things are going well, or whatever the case may be, and something triggers in him. He feels like, as he kind of explained to the officer in the body cam footage, you know, I was getting stir crazy. I needed to get out of the house. And like, maybe it just seemed like something was building up. And then he had this release that, you know, maybe he didn't think was going to be all that bad, but then he goes out and of course he's going to be a target on probably a very slow night in downtown Albuquerque. He allegedly shoots off a gun. We'll see if that, you know, turns out to be true, but draws all this attention to him, and something that he probably thought was going to be, you know, an innocent venture out ends up going probably worse than he could have ever imagined it possibly going. And it seems like these are, you know, repeat situations. He puts himself in very avoidable situations, and then it seems like he almost maximizes how poorly they can go for him. And it's just something, you know, he may want to say like, why me, bad luck, or, you know, if he wants to take the religious perspective, you know, I'm being chosen to be put through these battles, you know, God's strongest soldiers are the ones who have, you know, been through the worst wars, however you want to put it. There's clearly some like element he has, his psychology built towards, you know, these things repeatedly happening, and it's very concerning.
Yeah, listen, I mean, it's poor decision making is what it is. And I mean, listen, we've all done it, man. I'm not going to pretend like I haven't had too much to drink at some time and gotten behind the wheel of the car. I've done that. I'll admit that. So I'm not trying to crucify the guy. But man, it's poor decision making. And he has the luxury of a driver available to him that he can make use of. So, man, that's what I hope he gets help for, man. I hope that he can sort things out. Austin Allen chimed in and said, you know, if I did half of what John Jones has, I'd be rotting in prison the rest of my life. Listen. That is true, but that's not just John Jones, man. Unfortunately, that's the way the justice system works, and I think as we're seeing right now, at least, don't want to speak for Canada, Mike, but in the United States, we have some organizational problems in the government, and rich people tend to get treated a little bit different, so I won't say that that's anything John Jones related. Unfortunately, that just seems to be the system that we're in. There was a question here as well. Me Diamond 44 said, do you think John Jones will fight before the end of the year? So that kind of takes me, Mike, to what you think the UFC should do. Now, I'll say this. This is not priority number one for the UFC right now. They have got other problems to deal with. You know, Dana White is trying to soldier on with UFC 249. And then he says the whole schedule after that. So a lot going on. I don't even know that they're going to get to deal with this. I did see a social media clip the other day, I think, of Dana just kind of saying, oh, my God, you know, this is whatever. But they're not going to deal with it. But what do you think is going to happen? Now, that's a kind of a multi-layered question. Do you think he'll fight before the end of the year? Because, as we said, look, I don't know about the justice system. I have no idea what kind of punishment he's going to face. I read a little bit of what's on the laws for the New Mexico statutes, and I think he may face potentially a couple days in jail if he's convicted of anything. But I don't think it's going to be anything like long term or the guy's locked up for a year or anything along those lines. I think, again, we're probably going to talk about, you know, some counseling and some probation and that sort of thing. But I see a lot of people saying, should the UFC strip him? I'll be honest with you. I am not of the mind that the UFC should strip John Jones for this. This is bad behavior, but I don't know that, you know, if he's locked up for a lengthy period of time, then yeah, maybe you consider stripping him. I don't know that they necessarily need to strip him for this incident. I think, again, I think there's some underlying things here that really John just needs some help. But what do you think? I mean, obviously we can't predict what the legal system is going to do, but A, I guess, do you think the UFC should consider stripping him his belt? And B, do you think, to answer the question, he'll fight again before the end of the year?
I don't think they'll strip him. I mean, we've been through this before. John Jones, even when I believe it was after the drag racing incident, it was like a few weeks before the fight. He spent like about, you know, I don't know if it was a full night in jail or two nights in jail. And I remember him coming out and like doing interviews about it days later, talking about how, you know, traumatizing that experience was for him and all that kind of stuff. So I think even if he does see a few days in the jail cell, that's, like you said, not going to impact this whole thing too much. But on terms of how the UFC is going to treat him, I think they're just really going to take the, you know, follow the lead of the law, more or less. I think if, like you said, if something serious happens with John where he, you know, punished in a severe way, I think that's probably something they may have to look into and take into their decision-making process. But right now, we kind of spoke about it on the top, if there's any time to maybe have an incident that's going to delay a fighting future or, you know, bring questions about it, I guess now's the time when we don't know when John Jones was going to be fighting again, first of all. And, you know, now with this whole issue with the schedule, we don't know if that could push back a potential fight date, all these different things. So I think right now is like a time, I guess, that's almost beneficial to him in a way. It's not like the UFC is really hurting for big fights. And, you know, he was scheduled for a pay-per-view in 2 months and they're like, okay, he's unavailable. We need to, you know, slide someone else in there, like we've kind of seen in the past in these situations. So I think ultimately they just wait and see what happens. And I really can't see a situation where his belt is taken away. The UFC is really needs big draws right now. They need big money fights. John Jones is a big money fighter. He is a big draw. He is one of the names. They really need to help carry these pay-per-views and stuff. So unless their hand is really, really forced and they have to make a decision like that, I think it's going to be, you know, business as normal. They're going to book John Jones whenever he's available. If he feels comfortable fighting before the end of the year and they have a date open for him, 100% I see him getting in there.
Yeah, Jonathan Giroux, I hope I'm saying that last name right. He said, I can't help but think Jones is suffering from severe mental health issues, potentially some CTE from head trauma. Is it ethical to continue letting him fight before they address his underlying issues? Now, again, not a psychologist and certainly can't, you know, evaluate any potential CTE. I mean, in fairness, the guy hasn't been hit a whole lot in his career. So, I mean, if anybody is maybe potentially less at risk for serious CTE, it might be John Jones. But the underlying issues, man, that's the thing I think that needs to be addressed here. I mean, this the decision-making processes that are made when he has the means available to him, I think, as Mike said earlier, you know, just maximizes the worst possible situation, man. It's just not a good thing, man. I hope, you know, that you know, you keep saying, well, hopefully it'll come to a senses. Maybe this will be the time. And it just doesn't. It happens over and over and over. But the guy has the means to stay out of trouble. And I hope he'll potentially make some changes and evaluate what it is that keeps causing him to make these terrible, terrible decisions. So, all right, listen, UFC 249, as of now, still happening April 18th. Sensei Sama weighed in and said the probability of UFC 249 happening in your opinion, guys. So, man, I'll be honest with you. You know, when this whole thing started happening, the coronavirus outbreak really started making its ways into the United States. I mean, hell, we had some heated chats in the MMA Junkie Slack channel, man. To be honest with you, I stood fully in support of saying that I think the schedule happens as it is, man. I think they'll have the means. And at the time in Las Vegas, I mean, we hadn't shut down schools yet. We hadn't shut down the strip. So I just assumed, you know, the athletic commission would fall in line with the rest of the state government and say, you know, hey, we'll allow this thing to go on. You know, now things have been shut down and it's kind of a weird situation. UFC President Dana White said he wanted to make an announcement this week, but bottom line, he keeps saying the card is going to go on. The card is going to go on. In fact, it's going to be the biggest card ever. We're going to make it unbelievable. We know it can't happen at Barclays Center in Brooklyn, New York. I mean, man, things are really rough up in New York right now. So thoughts for everybody up there. Please stay safe. But Mike, what are your thoughts? I mean, does this fight happen? You know, hearing rumors it could be overseas. You know, everybody keeps asking me. I'm getting texts and phone calls from people in the industry. You know, I mean, people that work for the UFC, people that work in all aspects of it. They're saying, where is this thing going to happen? And listen, I've had a few conversations with Dana White about it, and he is staying tight-lipped. He says, I've got this thing locked up, But I don't know, man. It could be Abu Dhabi. It could be the UFC Apex 10 minutes from my house. It could be Florida we're hearing maybe. I mean, I don't know. What do you think the odds are this thing happens?
Yeah, it's hard to speculate because I guess us media scumbags don't really need to know any of the details here. But just joking. But still, like Dana, like you said, he's keeping this one extremely, you know, close to the vest. He's not seemingly telling the people who are the closest to this. You know, some of the fighters, the people that work with them really closely, they don't even know what is going on with this, where this fight's going to be. So it's really hard to sit here and speculate. If you just had to have me say yes or no, April 18th, do they fight somewhere? Does this happen? I'm going to say yes. Just because it seems like Dana White is taking like this is such a personal challenge, some, you know, almost like a, you know, an insult to his ability to do this. The people that are saying it shouldn't happen or it won't happen. So I think, you know, come hell or high water, he's gonna really, really try to make this event, you know, go off without a hitch, despite all the obstacles they've already had. So in that sense, I guess I'm betting on Dana White to pull this off. Do I agree with it? You know, maybe not necessarily. We don't need to get into all the politics of, you know, that side of it. Should events be happening, period? It's just, you know, they're going to do everything in their power to make this event go down April 18th. And I think Dana is going to find a location. What does the card look like? Does it end up being, you know, this mega event, all this type of stuff? I have some doubts there, but will Khabib Nurmagomedov and Tony Ferguson fight on April 18th? You asked me for an answer right now. I'm going to say yes.
Mark chimed in and said, besides the moon and an aircraft carrier, what viable locations do you forecast for 249? I will say this. As this thing is going on, my initial thought was, if this thing happens, it happens in the Middle East, right? We know that they have friends over there in the United Arab Emirates, and it seems like, you know, the government would kind of help them. At this point, I'm not so sure about that anymore. I think with the increasing international sanctions on travel, man, I think there could be some real problems just getting people around, shuffling people from place to place. And the last thing you want is somebody to be stranded or to find out they're told they can't get there or they can't get home or whatever the case may be. So I tend to think domestic. And again, it's, you know, you said we don't want to talk about the politics of it too much, but you do have to talk about the politics a little bit. I mean, you do have Donald Trump saying, you know, what, by Easter, he wants everything back up and running, which if that was the case, I mean, I guess full speed ahead for April 18th, right? But, you know, I don't know how much the state governments are gonna buy into that. You know, the state governments have some responsibility to their citizens as well. So even if Donald Trump says, hey, we're good, guys, it's 100%, let's go. You know, I can't imagine a New York, for instance, you know, that's mired in this thing right now saying, yeah, we're okay with that too. Let's start putting people together. So I don't know, you know, viable options. I don't know. We've heard behind the scenes that Florida is willing to do something. We know, for instance, that Submission Underground is happening on Sunday in Oregon. Now, I just talked to Chael Sonnen a few minutes ago, actually, and they are taking some incredible precautions. He said that they're actually the athletes. They're going to line up like campers outside of the arena. And so, like, instead of having locker rooms, like every athlete will be in like this camper truck by themselves. So that way, you know, they don't have anybody congregating. Chael is actually going to do the commentary by himself. So he's not even going to have two people. And that way he's like, dude, I have talked for a long time. I don't know if I've ever done 2 hours all by myself. So he's going to do the commentary on his own. I think he even told me the commentary will be outside. Like, he won't even actually be in the venue. They'll just have minimal camera work. And I mean, so there are ways to make this happen. I don't think, you know, UFC 249 is going to happen and it's just going to be, you know, fans there and attendance and all that. I mean, we know it's going to be behind closed doors. And I'll say this, and I know that I'm in the minority here, and I know I'm in the minority on my own staff, but I think there are ways to make these things happen, man. I think it has to be done safely. Again, crowds aren't going to be there. We've already said that. We've determined that. We're going to have to do things differently from a media perspective. You know, there was a question here, will MMA Junkie send somebody? It was a Jonathan Giroux again. He said, if the USA is still in lockdown from COVID, would you support them putting on events in other nations or in their own facility? Would you send someone from MMA Junkie to cover it? I'll be honest. I'm willing for these events. I think we're going to have to do things differently. I don't know if I'm willing to stand in a scrum with 20 other people shoulder to shoulder around me. I think we might need to do a little social distancing with our cameras. I think the ways to make these things happen, that to me is the way that we move forward from this, because, you know, the virus is not going to just go away. We got to figure out ways to change and to do things differently. And I think that's what the UFC is going to try to do. So my answer to this is I think UFC 249 is going to go on. I don't know where it's going to happen yet. I really don't. I wish I had some insight on that. UFC seems like it's set up to maybe not UFC 249, but moving forward once the Nevada State Athletic Commission meets again. So we'll see. Mike, would you feel comfortable covering events right now? Or would you, you know, if you got the call from Simon Simano, would you say, take my name out of the hat, bro. I'm not doing this.
I guess it depends where it is. I mean, if maybe it's a one-shot deal, if it ends up being in Florida, you know, you could get on a three-hour flight or something. Maybe going international, I think, would maybe be something that you'd have to take a little more consideration into, just because, you know, the lengthy flight, maybe having to go through multiple airports, things like that. You don't know what type of travel restrictions, how some of these countries are treating other people flying through there, all these different things. So I think really to answer that question, it comes down to the location and, you know, what type of media access would there even be to get there, because you're seeing some of these other events that are putting on, like I believe Chael's show on Sunday, no media access. Obviously in Brasilia, they kind of had to improvise because the media were already traveling there, assuming they were going to be covering, you know, a regularly set up UFC show. So I think they did something in like a hotel room back at the host hotel, something like that. So I guess you just need to know a little more details, but it's definitely a little concerning, the idea of traveling right now. And even more so when you talk about the people who really matter in this situation, that's the athletes, them traveling from different countries and doing all these things, especially in a state where they're going to be already weakened, their immune systems from getting into a weight cut and stuff. It's definitely a massive mountain for the UFC to overcome and a lot of risks they're taking, because I think unless you do have COVID-19 testing for everyone who is on the card and arguably anyone who's going to be in the arena, whether it's, you know, a referee to working a camera that night on April 18th, if this does happen, you are having a huge, huge risk. Because if there's just one case, and I'm honestly surprised, I know there was like a retired, you know, I forget his name, but like a relatively low level fighter that not many people know, who came out saying he had, you know, or he tested positive for coronavirus. All you need is one of those situations for someone tied to this event, and the UFC is going to get an ungodly amount of blowback. If even one person, though, God forbid, it's actually, you know, one of the competitors like Khabib or Tony or any other fighter on the card, but you have anyone stemming to that event who has it, who comes in with it or leaves with it, it's just going to be, the amount of backlash the UFC is going to get in the media is going to be unreal. And I think that's ultimately what a lot of the criticism is coming from. Is that worth the risk of that, worth the reward of just putting on this fight? And I know why they want to put on so badly at this time. Khabib Nurmagomedov starts Ramadan the week later. Like, it's all, you can just like, oh, let's do it in May. Like, it's not that easy. If you don't do this fight now, it's probably not going to be till September, October, November range. And of course, for the UFC, they want to put on this big fight now.
So a couple of things. HK chimed in and said, outcome of the NSAC meeting yesterday. For those that aren't aware, the NSAC meeting Wednesday was actually canceled. So they didn't host that event where they were going to address what their plans were moving forward. So as of right now, they don't have a plan for when they're going to reopen Nevada, so to speak, and be willing to host events. Just so people know, the local government has shut things down here in Nevada until at least April 15th. That's orders from the governor. So I don't think that, obviously, the state-appointed athletic commission is going to do anything outside of that. So I wouldn't think that we'd address anything in Nevada and Las Vegas events, which would mean, of course, the UFC Apex until at least that April 15th time. Mike, you talked about the UFC wanting to host the event. Meet Diamond 44 said, why would Tony and Khabib agree to such a huge fight under these unusual circumstances? Isn't it worth waiting given everything at stake? Now, you touched on the fact why waiting would mean a significant wait, not just a pushback, but what do you think? Because I had a conversation with Shajara Eubanks a couple days ago, and Shajara is on UFC 249. She says, I don't care where the fight is. You know, you take it to Antarctica and I'm on it. Just, you know, send the jet for me and I'll be there. And she told me, she said, listen, we're fighters. This is what we do. You understand what we do is already a risky behavior anyway. We're already putting our bodies on the line. I feel like we can do this. And of course, we know that, I've seen a lot of questions about, hey, how well are athletes able to train right now? I know here in Las Vegas, you know, we've talked to the crew over at Syndicate. We've talked to the crew at Extreme Couture. We've talked to some other athletes who have said, look, we are taking precautions. We're finding ways to train. You know, we're training in small groups, just maybe like me and one training partner. So it's definitely not the same kind of training. I don't know that it's necessarily not good. I mean, we're talking about two incredibly high level athletes who have been training martial arts their entire life. And I don't know that, you know, 3 weeks of not being able to spar is really going to affect their preparation that they're already, you know, competing at such a high level. Boiling it down to the original question, what do you think? What would be the motivation for Tony and Khabib to still step in there? I mean, we know why the UFC wants the fight to happen. I mean, they got to get the show back on the road, man. They got to get events happening. You know, they have bills to pay. But, you know, as far as Tony and Khabib, what do you think? Given the magnitude of this fight, do you think they're making a mistake. Is it worth waiting? What do you think their motivation is?
Man, this is a tough one because it's like any fighter, I feel like we almost can't trust or like take their opinion of being like, oh, you know, it's worth the risk, blah, blah, blah. Like, I'm willing to go in there and, you know, the coronavirus situation, I'm willing to put it to the wayside, et cetera, et cetera. Like, these are people whose profession that they go in there and cage fight. They're like inherently putting themselves in the way of danger in risky situations and stuff. So for them to like add one more on the top of the pile isn't really all that big of a deal. So of course they're going to say they're still willing to do it. And I think, you know, Khabib and Tony, I don't think, you know, everyone talks about how much money Khabib Nurmagomedov allegedly has in the bank. I don't think he's really doing this one for the payday. I think it's more for the legacy behind it. He said when we talked to him in Las Vegas at that Dominance MMA media day, which granted, this was before this got, you know, truly, truly crazy. It was kind of a different world even just a few weeks ago then. But he said, you know, we need this fight to happen because the lightweight division needs to go on. We have all these other contenders in the division who are on long winning streaks, and I need to get to fighting these guys. And like, this fight just needs to happen now for the sake of the division, for the sake of my title reign, all that stuff. And that's, I think, his primary motivator. But Khabib has been through a ton already in this camp. He went to the United States and was expecting to fight there, obviously, in New York, and was doing his thing at AKA. Then he went back to Russia. Now apparently he's gone to Abu Dhabi, and then who knows where he'll have to fly to, wherever this fight ends up being, potentially back to the States, maybe somewhere still there in the Middle East. We don't really know. But for him, he's been through a hectic amount, this training camp. And I think that almost benefits Tony Ferguson in a way. Like, hey, we're seeing all these crazy videos of fighters doing their home workouts, doing all this, you know, interesting, unique stuff. Like, this is what Tony Ferguson's been doing for years. This is his jam, being stuck in his house by himself, training in his jeans, doing weird stuff. Like, that's already what he's made of. So I think the mental impact of this probably is nothing on Tony. It's just his same old routine with maybe a few minor adjustments. He's still doing weird training techniques, weird things like that. So for Tony, I think if this fight does play out and go down on the 18th through these circumstances, that benefits him for in a little bit of a way. And we know Tony, man, that guy is always down to fight. He wants this so bad. He has everything to gain here. I think he's willing to kind of put all this stuff to the side and risk going through the situation if it means actually finally being locked in a cage with Khabib and getting to do their thing, because I know how badly he wants this fight and how badly he thinks he can win. So he's willing to do it all.
I think the probably really important thing to note here, by the way, is that, you know, things change so fast in the world right now, man. So any prediction we're offering about whether this thing is going to happen, I will throw a full caveat in there that 3 weeks from now, the world could be an entirely different place. So all the hurdles that Dana White and the UFC are trying to jump right now, I know they're trying to do them the right way. I mean, even though Dana's a little, you know, obviously he's a little brazen in the public and when he's talking to people on these live chats and that sort of thing. But behind the scenes, I've talked to some people who say, listen, man, Jeff Nowitzki, Dr. Jeff Davidson, I mean, they're taking full precautions. They're, you know, they're going through all the steps, working with the government. But that said, man, I think it's going to happen. I think we're going to be covering it. But, man, the world is changing at a rapid pace with this disease. So it's crazy. All right, let's switch things to a much lighter topic because I am so tired of COVID-19 and the ways – I'm now an elementary school teacher, by the way. Stay-at-homing is I'm teaching my kid at the moment, which is great. I mean, I love the family time, but I'm not a great elementary school teacher. So I'd like to apologize to my son up front. But Jonathan Giroux chimed in and said, look, as journalists who frequently work from home, what advice can you give new work-from-homers about staying productive? So, yeah, there you go. As you know, when we're not on the road covering events, we all work around the globe, you know, from home. So, Mike, what's your advice to these new people that have been in offices their whole life? What do you do to stay productive at home?
Yeah, I mean, right, it's kind of interesting. It's like basically the same thing we do anyway as living this life. It's just I don't really have the option of like going downstairs and going to the gym or like doing something like that. That would kind of fit into my day as well. But I think it's just as much as anything, like, building a routine. You know, you go to work, you come back, you do your things after. I mean, I think you just need to kind of get into a rhythm of figuring out, you know, what you want to accomplish in the morning of this day, the afternoon at this day, when you can fit a break in, maybe when you can do a home workout, all that different stuff. You know, you want to sit here and be like, oh, try new things, maybe read a book, you know, do a project, do some home improvements and stuff. I know it's not that easy for a lot of people. Sometimes it takes, you know, a week and a half of, you know, being lazy, and then you slowly build into your routine and then, you know, progresses from there. But that, I guess, would just be my main piece of advice. Try to kind of, you know, whether you, even if you need to write it down on a piece of paper and, you know, check off these things you want to do each day, I think it's really just about setting, you know, those daily goals and trying to tick them off.
Yeah, that's good. That's good advice there. You know, I've heard some people say, you know, you should still get up and like get dressed as if you're going into the office. I say that's completely wrong. I'm sitting in my boxers right now. Nobody even knows. You see what I'm saying? That's the great thing about working from home. So that would be my advice. Just work in your boxers if you feel like it. It makes you comfortable. And don't crack open your first frosty beverage until the workday is done. I mean, you technically could get away with it, but your productivity will probably go down. So that would be my solid advice. Well, Mike, listen, it is Friday night in Las Vegas, and it's a day off for me, so I've got big things to do, man. You're wasting my time here. The whole world is out there quiet and just waiting to be walked through with my family, and look, I'm happy doing the social distancing. I understand we all got to do it, and I'm down for it, but I do understand going a little bit stir-crazy, I'll say that.
For sure, man. Yeah. Well, just got to try to keep busy. I guess we'll see how this whole thing pans out in the next few weeks. Obviously, hopefully this gave the people some entertainment. I enjoyed doing this with you, and I think we'll have a lot more of these to come in, you know, the next few days, weeks, and everything, not just with us, but I think we'll be including the entire MMA Junkie staff. So you guys will get to hear a lot of different opinions, see a lot of different faces.
Yeah, right. Good stuff. All right. Well, listen, there you go. We got things to do. Not really, but we're going to go be in isolation by ourselves. Thanks for joining us. This was fun. We'll definitely do it again. Hopefully not in the days and weeks. You were about to say months to come. It better not be. It better be a couple days, maybe a week or two at tops. Hopefully we get back to normal. Hopefully get some fights. Thanks for joining us, guys.